Presentation of HIT's Journalist in Residence of 2014, Michele Catanzaro, and I would like to very briefly introduce him. Michele studied physics in Rome and earned his PhD at the Technical University of Barcelona, and for well over one decade now, he has been active as a freelance science journalist, publishing in four languages. In countries like Italy, Spain, Mexico, Great Britain, and maybe some others, through channels like the Nature Publishing Group, The Guardian, Physics World, El Periodico, and so on and so on. His research reporting interest is mostly focused on the intersection area between science, medicine, and technology, and this is one of the reasons probably why he was interested in coming to HITS, because of its interdisciplinary approach. Where many disciplines come together and interact, hopefully, in a productive way. He's also the co-author of a book on networks, a very short introduction, which was published in English and Spanish. He received last year the King of Spain International Journalism Prize and also the BBVA, which is a financial company, Innova Data Award for a project in data journalism. Michele has been with us since August and will still be with us for a while. Thanks for coming. I wish you a lively discussion with Michele, which certainly will happen after the presentation. And Michele, thanks for presenting your stuff. Thanks. Good luck. Bye-bye.
Okay, first of all, thanks to you for being here and to HITS for organizing this talk. I've decided to start with a tabloid-like title. Science in the media, it can kill, it can save lives. So with this inaccurate but attention capturing title, what I want to tell you is that I will start by showing you a couple of examples of how really science journalism can impact society, and even maybe more interestingly, how it can impact science itself. The first example is a very tragic one. In fact, it's a story I've partially covered for Nature. The case of Hernando Mendez Salinas, a Mexican biotechnologist who got killed one night in November 2011. The murder was claimed by an anarcho-primitivist organization called Individuals Standing Toward the Wild, who basically is inspired in an ideology that thinks that technology is perverting nature, is perverting especially human nature, and has been behind or has claimed a chain of letter bombs sent to several Mexican research centers. I'm telling you this story because in their notes online, very lengthy notes they post online, they consistently quote a specific area of, let's say, science popularization literature, which goes under the tag of transhumanism. The idea behind transhumanism is the idea that technology is pushing up to a tipping point after which, basically, we will emancipate ourselves from natural selection, and we will be able to do things like, you know, downloading our brain on a chip or living eternally. By the way, it's a literature that is proposed by very respectable scientists. For example, you have here Bill Joy, who was chief scientific advisor at Sun Microsystem. Then you have Ray Kurzweil, who is now scientist at Google, or Eric Drexler, the author of one of the first popularization books about nanotechnology, who is an engineer from the MIT. By the way, these at least two of these publications quote another very famous guy, Ted Kaczynski, better known as the Unabomber, the Harvard mathematician that at a certain point decided to leave research and go into a hut in the woods and started sending letter bombs too. In fact, even if the tone, overall tone of many of this literature is very utopian, there is also a dystopian side to it. So that is very well explained by the title of this article by Bill Joy, Why the Future Doesn't Need Us. The idea is that technology may get to a point in which devices like robots or nanorobots are much better than the human beings, and the human beings become obsolete. So, obviously, I'm not claiming that this literature is in any way responsible of the killing of a scientist. Note the direction of the arrows, let's say. But what I'm saying is that the way in which science is portrayed in the media, the narrative, the framing around science can really break open the doors of the laboratory and impact on the life of scientists, even in a very tragic way, like in this case. Now let me give you a positive example. The example is the following. In 1998, British doctor Andrew Wakefield published a famous and now infamous paper in The Lancet, in which he established a connection between the MMR vaccine and autism. After the publication of this paper, there was a dramatic decrease in the use of MMR vaccines in the UK, with all its health consequences. And from 2004 to 2011, the science journalist Brian Deer at the Sunday Times carried on a painstaking investigation in which he found evidence of massive cherry-picking, manipulation of data, and conflict of interest in the work of Andrew Wakefield. He found things like, for example, that the volunteers that were used in this study in fact were mostly member of anti-vaccine campaigns, that even their condition was not reported correctly, and moreover that Wakefield at that time was teaming with a lawyer to set up a company that would actually act in lawsuits against institutions and companies related to vaccines. And in fact in 2010 the paper was retracted, partially due to the effort by Brian Deer. So here we have another case in which science journalism really has an impact on society as a whole and on science in particular, but in this case a positive one. So these examples should suggest, I hope, that the traditional naive view of how science journalism work should be somehow updated. What I mean by this naive view, this traditional view, it is somehow the following. The idea is that science is done in the lab, let's say kind of in the vacuum. Scientists then pass like packets the information to journalists who somehow metabolize it, process it, and make it accessible to the public that will receive it. So these examples show that, in fact, the picture is much more complex. Here, we should add some feedback loops. For example, in both the cases I've shown you, there is a feedback loop between the activity of journalists and what happens in the laboratory. So for the sake of this presentation, I will mainly focus on the first feedback loop, the science journalism feedback loop, which is somehow more specific to science, while this one is more, let's say, general to journalism. But I will say something about this, and then obviously we can discuss later in the debate. So, what I mean by the science journalism feedback loop? Let us start with the less obvious part of the feedback loop, that is the influence that journalism exerts on science. In the traditional naive view, somehow this influence is almost non-existing. The idea is that science is done in the lab, and that journalism is something that is done outside of it. It's kind of an appendix. It's something that doesn't influence, doesn't relate to what happens in the laboratories. But in fact, beyond the example I've shown you at the beginning, there is evidence from media studies that show that this is not the case. This is a very famous, I would say, seminal paper published in the 90s that demonstrated that the fact that a piece of research, that a paper was covered in the New York Times implied an plus of citations to that paper. Citations, I mean, by scientific literature, within the scientific literature. So this is something quite impressive, because it shows that a core mechanism of science, like citation, is in fact influenced by something that in principle could be thought as outside of science, like science journalism. In fact, there is an important detail to mention regarding this study, that is that one could argue that, okay, New York Times journalists are good enough to select papers that would have had this plus of citations anyway, but the researchers could exploit a specific circumstance in the story of the New York Times to find that, in fact, the direction of the correlation was the one that I said, that is, from publication to in the newspaper to citation in the scientific literature. The circumstance was that the New York Times had a 3-month strike in which the paper didn't go out to the street, but journalists still maintained an internal edition of the paper to, let's say, avoid breaking the continuity of the archive. So the criteria for selecting which papers should be covered in the newspaper were the same, but this effect disappeared because of the effect of the citation plus disappeared because the paper didn't circulate. So now that I hope I've convinced you that in fact science journalism really has a strong impact on science, let us focus on this other feedback, this other part of the feedback loop. What is the naive, let's say, vision in this case? The vision is that the communication is, beyond being unidirectional, which we have found it is not the case, is something unbiased without any specific intention in it. In the following, I think I will show you that this is not the case. First of all, I will use as an example to explain this the case of press releases, which is one of the many channels through which science, let's say, addresses the world of journalism, but it is a very significant one. For those of you, I know that most of you are journalists, but for a part of you are journalists, for those of you that are not familiar with press release, very quickly I will show you an example. This is Eureka Lab, which is the main portal for press releases. Basically, if one is can demonstrate that he or she is a journalist, he or she can get access to this portal. And what you get is that basically you get in advance summaries of what the main scientific journal will publish that week, for example. So here you see Science, PNAS, Lancet, Cell, etc. You usually get this under what is called an embargo policy. Here, on top of the press release, this summary of what will be published, you see that there is an expression, embargo for release, which means that you agree with Eureka Lab, in this case, Nature has its own platform, not to publish anything about this specific discovery before a time that is established by the journal, which is usually the time at which the paper is published. And moreover, you agree that you will not make public the privileged information to which you get access. So this is a very quick introduction to what press releases are. These are press releases from journals, but there are press releases from scientific institutions and almost from any stakeholder involved in science. So in this very interesting study, carried on also in the 90s, it was found that really press releases have a key role in shaping what gets published in the media. What these studies found is that 84% of the news that were published in 7 major international newspapers were in fact preceded by a press release issued by 4 of the main international scientific journals. 84%, that is only 16% were things that somehow journalists had found independently of press releases. In fact, the picture is even, let's say, more striking, because this is not a real study, it's a kind of little experiment that a blogger made at The Guardian. He basically looked into the press releases that the UCL, the University College London, had released in 2011, and he found evidence that in major British newspapers, those press releases were really copy-pasted with the rates of copy between 41 and 97%. So it's really a massive impact from the press releases industry, let's say, on what gets published in the newspapers. In fact, this has even created a new word invented by a BBC journalist, the word churnalism, from the English verb to churn, which is kind of what you do when you, for example, shake milk to make butter. It's this idea that you basically, instead of doing your kind of traditional reporting, what you do is basically get PR information, move it a little bit, and put it on the page. So, sorry, summarizing this part of this discussion of the cycles, we have seen that there is a big machinery that sends press releases, for example, or a lot of pieces of information from the scientific world to the journalistic world. What gets published in the newspapers ends up having an effect on core mechanisms like, for example, citations in journals. And an independent check that this picture is true was obtained in 2012 in a study that found that, in fact, papers that were advertised through a press release had an increased rate of citation. So let's say the circle is closed. So by now, I've only portrayed the situation. I'm not claiming whether it is good or bad. But in the following part, I will show you that it is very easy that a situation like this one slips into a scenario that I have called here with another, let's say, tabloid-like title of propaganda machinery. Note that I'm not claiming that the peer apparatus of science is all propaganda. On the contrary, I think it's absolutely essential. Press releases are a key tool with which none of us would work. What I'm saying is that it can somehow, under certain circumstances, take this role of propaganda. So why am I claiming that this can happen? This is an example, a 2002 study that found that between the press releases published by 9 prominent medical journals, only a little minority noted some key issues, like, for example, whether the study had limitations or whether the study was industrially funded. So imagine, with an input of information like this one, plus journalism, that is, plus basically taking this information and translating it to the page, what can happen? It can happen, obviously, that what you get on your outlet, on the media, completely ignores things like this. There is a risk of hype, there is a risk of ignoring the conflict of interest. Even the embargo mechanism in itself has been criticized by several journalists and media scholars, because the situation is the following. If you have an embargo agreement, in principle, you could not talk with anybody about that news before you publish it, or at least before the embargo is published. I mean, it depends on the embargo agreement, in which one it is. But for example, there is this very famous case, which I think it was debated earlier, the case in this place, the case of an alleged connection between GMOs and toxicity, in which the journalists were explicitly asked to sign an agreement that contained this commitment not to double-check, let's say, the information. So, what happens is that what I've shown in this slide is that there is really a risk that the peer or the communication mechanism that goes from science to the journalism transforms into a propaganda mechanism. But if you remember, this is a feedback loop. So the risk extends to science itself again. There is a kind of boomerang effect on science. And here I've put 3 examples in an increasing degree of, importance somehow. So this is plenty of examples that one could find a paper on the analgesic effects of beer that was published on Nature, but note in which date is the 4th of January, that is just 2 days before the day in which the kings bring gold, myrrh, and all the presents to the faith of Jesus. So it may be a coincidence, but it may be that the media awareness, let's say, of the editor has come into place here. There is even a more striking example, maybe you remember it, in 2005 and 2006, a couple of papers were published talking about a family of quadrupedals in Turkey, a family of people that walked on their all four, it generated a real wave, massive wave of coverage, all based on the idea that they may be the missing link between, you know, we and the apes or whatever, which was not the case. In fact, it was basically a brain problem. But what is interesting is that this reference to the missing link was engineered in the abstract of the two papers. That is, the two abstracts of the two papers, with doubtful basis, included ambiguous reference to the idea that these people may be models for revolution, etc. So also in this case, there are some suspects that the scientists themselves, let's say, incorporated this media expectation. And then there is the most extreme case, the case of scientific fraud. For example, the case of Jan Hendrik Schön, wonder boy that published a lot of papers before 2002 about organic semiconductors, and that were found in the end to be fraudulent. During a very interesting investigation, it was found that, there are declarations from editors from both Science and Nature that admit that they were kind of somehow happy to receive papers from Schön. They even somehow, in certain occasions, facilitated the review process for several reasons, because he gave very good news, and also because these kind of papers allowed to counterbalance the abundance of relevant results in biology with other results in material science. So also this may be a case in which this media awareness ends up modulating or changing how science work. So as I told, I will not say much about the second part of the feedback loop, we can discuss it later, just one point that for me is quite important for the following. What is at stake in the communication of science in science journalism and how science is communicated to the public is not only the content, it's not only the specific finding that you are talking about, it's also the framing of science. What do I mean by the framing of science? To explain it, I will refer to a paradigm developed by a political scientist, Dan Kahan, which is very interested in perception of risk, the paradigm of cultural cognition. Just to, I will explain two quick experiments he made. In this case, he took a group of people that had different positions regarding nanotechnology, and he provided them a packet of very well-funded, very objective information about nanotechnology. And then he put them at discussing and measured how polarized they were after the discussion. And then compared what happened with another group that was not provided with this input of information. What he found was that, which for me is kind of very, disturbing, is that the group that was provided with information, in fact, ended up more polarized than the group that was not provided with information. It seems that each part used this objective information to reinforce their own positions. So if somehow bare information is not enough, what else is needed? Here you have another experiment by Dan Kahan, which is even more disturbing, but somehow also funny. In this case, the issue was the papillomavirus vaccine that generated in several countries a division of opinion, whether it was appropriate or not to use it extensively. So here, Kahan grouped people according to their overall values, whether they were more egalitarian, communitarian, or more individualistic, hierarchist, and he fed this group with written opinions by some fake experts. These opinions were either in favor or against the vaccination, and the experts were somehow characterized in a way, so either by their appearance or by their alleged CV and publication, in a way that they may seem closer or not to the values of this group. What he found is that when a person had a certain conviction, a certain position, if an expert seemed to share this position, and moreover, this expert seemed to share the value of this person, then the position was reinforced. When this didn't happen, the position was not reinforced. So, what is the take-home message of all this slide? What I'm saying is not obviously that information doesn't matter and that only the packaging and the rhetoric that is around information matters. What I'm saying is that really the framing of scientific information, how it is connected with social debates, with the values of people, is as much important as the content. And so we should ask ourselves, when we talk, going back to this propaganda thinking, whether we are passing to the media the framing of the scientific information that is provided by, let's say, the PR industry. Now it's time to remind you the case of the nanoterrorists. In that case, it is clear that nanotechnology, by transhumanists, it is framed in a very specific way, like an infinitely powerful technology, while there are many alternative and equally compelling and interesting framing that could be used. I have an example. If you want later, I can show it to you. So, to conclude this part, I would like to address two questions. First of all, why is science putting in place a mechanism that so easily slips into propaganda, and why are sometimes journalists willing to buy in this propaganda? The reasons why science is putting it in place are very complex. They range from personal visibility to economic pressure to ideological issue. The easiest way I have to explain it is talking about a specific example, the Human Genome Project. The Human Genome Project was announced and the official PR from scientific institutions during many years had tones like the one you can see here. For example, the Nobel laureate Walter Gilbert said that one day we could pull out a CD out of our pockets and say, here's a human being, here, this is me. Obviously, we know now, and even at the time, there were some clues that the genes were not all that explains what a human being is. There are many genetic factors and microRNAs, etc. Or another example of what was the tone at that time is this editorial by an editor at Nature that was published on The Guardian, in which he said that basically, thanks to the Human Genome Project, we will be able to have things like extra limbs or even wings to fly. This had an impact on how the media covered the story. This has been very well documented by the science historian Matias González Silva in the Spanish press, and specifically in El País, which is the largest newspaper written in Spanish. She found, in a study that has analyzed thousands of articles for 30 years, that while in the early 80s, the news about health were mostly about multifactorial elements, environmental elements, and others, they quickly changed into very simplified news of the kind of the gene of obesity, the gene of diabetes, etc. And by the way, 10 years after the Human Genome Project, Nature itself published an editorial, Best is Yet to Come, in which it was admitted in several points that there was really an overexcitement, an overhyping regarding the project. So what explains this? Matias González Silva identifies plenty of factors that explains why there was some level of overhyping, but I would like to highlight two. First of all, we are in a post-Cold War time in which in public investment of science is not increasing anymore exponentially without a limit, and the Human Genome Project is an example of really big science So it had to be justified to have an investment so big as this one. And then there is an even more subtle issue, that is the argument that health was basically related to what you inherited, to genes, resonated a lot with the social and political environment of the time after the Reagan and Thatcher era, in which health conditions were really willingly related to, more willingly related to what you inherited than to social condition, environmental condition, etc. So this is a nice example for me of how economic factors, ideological factors, etc. come into place in this propaganda machine. And so why are journalists so willing to buy into this story? There are many reasons. There are reasons that go far beyond science journalism, but let me quote a couple of them. In this survey that was done by Nature in 2009, it was found that science journalists consistently highlighted that in the last 5 years they had experienced basically less time and more work. Staff cuts and an increased number of assignments. Obviously, this is the perfect the perfect situation, let's say, the perfect starting point for easily bringing in a PR, because if you have well-packaged, well-designed information that you can churn a little bit and put on the page, if you don't have time and you have a lot of work, it is easy that somebody accesses to doing these kind of things. But I would say that science journalism is especially weak, especially fragile in front of propaganda, because in fact at the origin of science journalism there is a mission or a commitment of acting somehow as PR for scientists. This has been very well documented by historians, but I will just give you an example that is, for me, very clear. William Lawrence, a New York Times reporter, which was in fact the only one that was invited by the Pentagon to cover the bombings of Japan, the atomic bombings of Japan, at the same time was on the payroll of the War Department in the US, writing press releases on issues like the bomb. And one could see in what he wrote in the New York Times that this had an impact on his work, but nonetheless, in 1946, he was awarded a Pulitzer Prize for his work. So really, at that time, this mixture of journalism and PR was something considered as natural for the sake of science communication. Obviously, then in the 60s, many things happened, and we are not anymore in these situations, absolutely, but okay, we should remember what our origins are. So, by now I've somehow painted a very bleak scenario in which really propaganda is prevailing. It's a scenario that I call the agenda-setting scenario, in which really there is this flux of biased information from science to journalism, and the attitude of journalists towards science is the one well explained by the case of Lawrence, an attitude that has been deemed as cheerleading, as an enthusiast applause towards scientists, with side effects, by the way, that we have seen with those three examples that I showed you before, like reinforcing, for example, trends within science. However, this is not the only possible scenario. There is another scenario, which I call the democratic participation scenario, and now I will hope in the last part of the talk to lift your spirit with a more optimist view, in which the communication mechanism, the peer mechanism from science, really works as a tool for engaging society with science and as a tool for transparency and not for bias, and on the other hand, in which the attitude of journalists towards science is more inspired by what has been deemed as watchdogging, as critical scrutiny. This cheerleader watchdog, couple of words has been invented by made famous by a cover of Nature in 2009 in occasion of the World Conference of Science Journalists, whose title was exactly this one: Science Journalists, Cheerleaders or Watchdogs. Me personally, I prefer another metaphor that I think is even more illuminating, which is the following. That is, should we look more like sports journalists or movie critics. These two both love the subject on which they write. They are both interested in the subject on which they write, but while sports journalists usually, at least in Southern Europe, I don't know whether in Germany it's the same, while they usually have a very partial position and they take very strong positions and they see their commitment as maintaining the public excited around sports, movie critics, on the contrary, although they love the subject they write about, they understand that they must keep a distance, and that an important function they have to carry on is this framing function. I like a lot this picture because of this. So, what can we do to push the journalism feedback loop from the agenda setting scenario to the democratic participation scenario? There are many things at stake, many things that, like, for example, how the media is organized, etc. What I will focus is what I know better, that is what individual journalists can do. I'm a freelancer, so it's basically the only thing I can do. So what are the rules of the thumb from my point of view for what we can do to push the feedback loops towards a democratic participation scenario? Basically, they are summarized in the title of the talk, that is trying to put more journalism in our activity as science journalists. When I say more journalism, what do I mean? I mean the definition of journalism that was given by George Orwell. Journalism is printing what someone else does not want printed. Everything else is public relations. So obviously, this is very radical, and I wouldn't say that all good science journalism responds exactly to this one, but I keep it as a kind of ideal, or a reference, or a call, let's say, to put more critical spirit, more scrutiny, more investigation in science journalism. How is this translated into practice? Basically, my call is to go beyond simple popularization or even simple news reporting about the last cutting-edge results and really think hard about how science can matter to society. So, at an even more practical level, this translates for me into the classic rules of journalists, like being suspicious of information that you get, fact-check it, ask yourself about the framing of the information, not only the specific facts, but how a narration is built out of this fact. And even more importantly, I try to, whenever I put myself at writing an important story, I try to see whether there are two basic ingredients. First of all, a good original story, something that is not necessarily PR-fed, and moreover, it's a compelling story, because if you really want to build an independent framing with respect to that, the one that you get from the propaganda machinery, you really need to have good stories. And then a special attention for conflicts, for controversies, which bring us back to this definition of George Orwell. A practical rule of the thumb for doing this is always keeping in mind what is the context of scientific discovery and bringing it in as much as you can in your work. So the context of the scientific discovery or the world of science, as I called it, is basically all these elements like policy, funding, human resources, ethics, internal debates in the scientific community that help us to build this thing. The good news is that there's plenty of good science journalism there. In order to prepare this presentation, I made a kind of internal survey in my personal records about good science journalism examples, and I found that basically you can find examples from everywhere in the world, you can find examples from every branch of science, you can find it in many different formats, ranging from investigative to data journalism to narrative journalism to new forms of narratives on the internet. I will finish by listing a set of examples, or by explaining quickly a set of examples that are for me references of what this journalism committed to democratic participation should be. The first one is a very nice one because it shows how a scientific institution, the British Medical Journal, really embraced this positive feedback loop between science and journalism, It's an investigation that they assigned to a team of investigative journalists, basically to check whether the WHO doctors that had written the recommendation of stockpiling antivirals, that recommendation that made Roche and other pharmaceutical companies make so much money, especially in the H1N1 crisis, whether they had some kind of conflict of interest, as it was claimed around. And they found that, in fact, they had. Basically, the three of them were on the payroll of these companies. And this investigation had such a big impact that the WHO decided to change the policy of disclosure regarding these kind of studies. Another nice example is the work done by the American science journalist Rebecca Skloot, a 10 years long investigation into the story of Henrietta Lacks. Henrietta Lacks is this woman here, an Afro-American woman, who is the one that donated what are now known as the HeLa cells. HeLa Henrietta Lacks. These cells were the first line of immortal cells. They were involved in plenty of very important discoveries. They were the base of, I mean, the initial capital of the modern biotech industry. Rebecca Skloot investigated all this, and she did. Discovered even more. That is, she discovered that the family of Rebecca Skloot, Henrietta Lacks, had not seen a cent of all this very big business. And moreover, they still continue to be deprived of Afro-Americans, and they had received information about how important the cells of their mother and their grandmother were, but they weren't able to process this information, so they thought that their grandmother was scattered in fridges around the world, that she could suffer out of these scientific experiments. And so I think this was a great investigation that was published into a book, because it really highlighted things like, for example, the importance of informed consent, which was not in place at the time of Henrietta Lacks, and also the attitudes of Afro-Americans towards tests. Till now, there is a very little participation of Afro-Americans, for example, in AIDS tests, because they remember having been used, and that's demonstrated. In tests, a little bit in a kind of unethical way. Another very interesting story, which is a small one, but it tells a lot about how much really science journalists can do, is the investigation carried on by the Indian journalist Pallava Bagla about a prediction of the IPCC, the International Panel for Climate Change. Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change. There was this 2007 prediction that said by 2035 the Himalayan glaciers are going to disappear. And this puzzled a lot Indian scientists, because they saw that instead the glaciers were not receding, on the contrary, some of them were expanding. So Bagla covered all this controversy, and in the end he demonstrated that there was a mistake that was recognized by IPCC, and this is very kind of striking, because the more probable hypothesis, or the hypothesis that he defends, is that it was a typo. It was 2335 and not 2035. So I've shown you examples from the life sciences, from the environmental sciences, but one can find examples in chemistry, in computer science, etc. And then let me show you a couple of examples from what I call this world of science, this context of scientific discovery and science, scientific development. This is a great work that was done by Seth Schulman, an investigative journalist, who was assigned this work by an NGO, the Union of Concerned Scientists, who was worried about widespread claims that the Bush administration was massively bending scientific evidence. During 3 years, Seth Schulman investigated the case, and he found, in fact, striking evidence that this was the case. Here I've shown just one of the graphs he has elaborated, in which you can see that the list of endangered species drops quickly and enormously and suspiciously with the change from the second Clinton administration to the first Bush administration. He also found that scientists were systematically fired if they from public institutions if they expressed positions that were not aligned with the priorities of the government. This sparked a widespread debate in the US that even brought some of the scientists to be hired back. One last example is also an example about this world of science, this context of scientific discovery, but I add it because it's also an example of what of the trend of data journalism. It's a work done by Peter Haldus. He scrutinized the practice that is allowed by the proceedings of the National Academy of Science, that is that the members of the National Academy of Science have a privileged track to publish on PNAS. They have 4 papers per year that they can publish with a very mild reviewing process. So he studied 10 years of this practice and he investigated the power users of the mechanism. That is, those that used it to publish almost 4 papers every year. And he found that several of them were current or former members of the editorial board of the PNAS, and there was also 2 Nobelists, 2 Nobel laureates. So a very interesting story, both for the method, data journalism, and for the content. Then here I put 2 modest contributions of myself, not because they are at the level of the former ones, not at all, it's only because I have done it myself, so I know them, and just in case you're curious. So this is the story that I uncovered and covered for Nature and other outlets about Omid Kokabi, a physicist that worked in Barcelona, a PhD student in physics that was worked in Barcelona and that has been jailed in the last 4 years, accused of being a spy, while he has claimed that he, in fact, has been jailed for refusing to cooperate in a nuclear military project. In the last couple of years, he has received support from the main scientific organization, and recently 31 Nobel laureates have asked for his freedom, and now, a couple of weeks ago, the Supreme Court in Iran has accepted retrying him. And then another project I've carried on in a completely different setting is a data journalism project I've done for El Periódico, a Spanish newspaper for which I write, which is called Fugados. It's basically, we have interviewed through an online platform and collected data about more than 700 Spanish scientists who have fled the country as a consequence of the effects of the financial crisis. So, in conclusion, here I've put some of the books and sources from which I've extracted the information, and thanks for your attention.